क्लाउड सर्वर, ओके। सो हियर वी गो, वी बिगिन विथ आवर ओन नॉट द मटेरियल दैट वी आर प्रेजेंटिंग हियर, द पिक्चर्स, वीडियोस, ओके, दे आर ऑल टेकन फ्रॉम ऑनलाइन सोर्सेस एंड दे आर यूज्ड फॉर एकेडमिक पर्पजेस ओनली। सो इफ आई आस्क यू व्हाट इज सिनेमा, everybody has some answer, okay, and in fact there is someone, mic is on, there's a lot of sound coming. Not sure who is that, unable to see. Yeah, thank you. So what is cinema? We are all grown up by watching different types of movies, films, and many other forms of visual culture. Cinema has a very specific stand in there. Okay, and in fact, cinema was discovered, invented before. Cinema was invented even before the television came into existence. Okay, and the first feature film, what we call today, was made in 1912. So it has more than 100 years of history. Okay, but earlier the cinema was silent, and then there was the inclusion of voice. So initially it was also made difference between the silent movies and talkies. Okay, so cinema is the modern day literature having maximum reach to the common man compared to any other form of literature. If we consider different types of literature, different types of art forms, okay, then cinema is one art form which reaches, okay, maximum number of common men. Okay, and in fact cinema has evolved from art into an industry. So due to its reach and impact on the lives of the people, cinema becomes one of the most studied areas of cultural life. Okay, so basically we are looking at all these media forms from the perspective of culture and society. The cinematic text expands the categories of language by blending music, scenery, and action in a cohesive way. So if you look at cinema carefully, and there is the form or art of music, there is an art of drama, there is an art of painting, there is an art of rhetoric. Okay, so all the different forms of arts are included in the art form of cinema, and that is why cinema has become such a powerful art form. There is a constant discussion about the film theory is regarding the high and low culture of cinema. Like we make the distinction between the mainstream cinema or commercial cinema and the artistic or parallel cinema. Okay, and there is a lot of discussion going on about it, that which is the real form of art in cinema. Okay, because most of the films that we watch and that comes to our theaters, they are primarily a commercial film which is made to create profit out of it. But even in that process of commercial cinema, there is a lot of art involved, big number of artists are involved. Okay, so here we will have to, when we make this distinction between commercial cinema and artistic or parallel cinema, we will have to understand that what is the perspective of the filmmaker. Okay, and in cinema it is a very interesting thing. Like when we talk about cinema, we say author of the cinema. So in this case, author is not the writer of the story, is not the writer of screenplay, is not the writer of dialogues. In case of cinema, the director itself is the author. Okay, so the artistic perspective that we are looking at, we will have to look from the perspective of the director. For example, Gangs of Wasseypur. Okay, it is a very famous film. In fact, it has become a kind of identity in the world about the Bollywood. Okay, and this film is not just about the rivalry of a group of people, or it's not a revenge. Okay, this film is basically seen from the perspective of meta cinema, a cinema that comments on the cinema. Okay, so I'll show you one simple dialogue from it, so that we understand that how it works. I'll show you a small video from the movie's two minutes and some seconds video, where the villain of the film, Ramadhir Singh, comments about cinema and comments about what kind of impact it has on the cinema. I hope you will be able to hear it. I think the voice is not coming to you people, so I have yeah, it is being played, but you can't hear it. I don't know why. So I have made kept a link where were you people able to hear it? Yes or no? Now okay? Audible?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. So I'll continue. Okay. I think the audio is not passing through. So I have kept the link of this particular video here. So you can check the link later and listen to it. So basic thing that they were talking about is that with cinema, there is a concept of heroism enters when, as an audience, when we watch the film, there is a kind of a movie going on in our mind as well. Okay, and we, most of us, when watch the movie, we identify with the heroes, and that is why. Okay, that everyone thinks of himself or herself as the protagonist. Okay, so that is the kind of impact that the cinema gives us. Okay, that for some time at least, we become hero in our mind for the given film or for the given sequence. Okay, and that is the basic what we call impact of the cinema, and it is created very, very deliberately. Okay, it's not just the outcome of, say, some sort of accidental outcome. there is a lot of theory going on behind that. So what's happening here is that the composite nature makes cinema powerful. That there are a lot of things. Okay, there is one more video here. I will not play now, but you can check it later when you get it. The narration of the action unfolds through camera shots, montage, and other types of cinematic techniques. Okay, so it's not just a storytelling or pictures coming on the screen. There are a lot of things going on when a sequence is going on screen. And this is where cinema becomes powerful. That composite nature of all those things, or everything together, creates a message that brings the audience into the screen. Then there is music, which is added to emphasize the dramatic and emotional aspects. In our real life, there is no music. Okay. But in cinema, music is the indicator that there is something dramatic, there is something crucial is going on or will happen. Okay. So there are a lot of indexicality when the musics are being played. Together, the experience of the text is synesthetic, blending different sensory modalities. We see, we hear, we think about it, we feel about it, and when we move on to the 3D and 5D kind of cinema, then the sensory experience is even bigger. So there are two very important theoretical standpoints to look at cinema. Okay, the first, as I mentioned, Auteur theory. It's a French word. The theory argues that everything in the text of cinema is because auteur, that is director, wanted it to be there. Okay. That everything we see on the screen and every single sound that comes from the scene, okay, from the screen, that is because the author wanted it to be there. The director wanted it to be there. A distinct trait of the author is visible on the text. Okay, that it is called signature of the author. For example, there are directors like Stanley Kubrick or Alfred Hitchcock, okay, or Tinto Brass, or even in case of India, you have Satyajit Ray, you have Manoj Kumar as a director, okay, Guru Dutt as a director. Okay, that by looking at their films, you can identify readily that yes, this can be done only by Manoj Kumar, only by Satyajit Ray. So they have a distinct signature on their own art. Okay, the way a painter marks his painting in a specific characteristic, a director marks his film in a very specific characteristics. Okay, so that is called the signature of the author. And second theory, which developed against the auteur theory, because every author is not consciously making the signature of on his work. So there you will have to analyze the cinema in terms of genre. Okay, so that is called genre theory. The theory developed in dissatisfaction of auteur theory argues that every genre has its codes and narrative of cinema becomes comprehensible because of those semiotic codes. For example, if I say horror movies, then there are identifiable codes and signs of horror movies. By looking at it, you can identify, yes, this movie looks like horror or it is scary. Okay, so even if there is no what we call supernatural element in the movie becomes the horror the way it was treated. So this is where the genre becomes important, that from which genre the movie comes. There are different genres like horror movies, thrillers, suspense, actions, comedy, drama, romance, okay, so then rom-com, okay, biographical. All these are different genres, okay, and movies are made in all these different genres, and we can really identify it. And there are movies that challenge not only the genre but also the standard powerful narrative. For example, this was one of such movies. It was an Indian film, Om Dar Badar. I'm sure none of you must have heard about it. The movie was made in 1988. Okay. But every other film is a kind of some genre. I will be giving you the answers. Yes. Okay. Om Dar Badar was made by Kamal Swaroop, and in 1988 the film was ready to release. Okay. But film never got the censor certificate because it was a very, very harsh satire of socio-political situation of the country. Okay. The film is available on YouTube now. The film was released after 25 years, that is in 2013. Okay. And if you watch the movie, like I shared one movie yesterday, Unshiye Andalo, about the movie by Salvador Dali and Louis Buñuel. Okay. So that was one of the most important absurd and surrealistic presentation on the screen. And these people have made that movie to get accepted in the surrealist school. Okay. Okay. Similarly, this film was also made in order to comment about the narratives that are going on around us. Okay. And there are many such movies which challenge the standard narratives. Suppose you watch any film of Alejandro Jodorowsky. He has made only 7 films in his 39 years of career. But all of them are something challenging for us as a film theorist or as an audience. So first we will talk about the cultural aspects of the films, and we will look at how films are made in Indian cinema, how commercial and mainstream cinema is working in India. And I'm basically talking about the Hindi films here because I have very little experience of other language films. I have seen, but I am not an expert to comment on that. So the first and most important aspect of any film is the hero. Okay. And like in our case in India, we watch the film because of the hero. Okay. If you are looking at a cinema from an artistic perspective, then you will not go by the name of the hero. You will go by the name of the director, because director is the artist. Fine. So, but in our case, we are more into the commercial cinema, and that's why we identify with the hero. We will see, okay, whose film is this? Salman Khan hai, Akshay Kumar hai. Okay. So that hero is the very important part of our narrative. And they are not only important part from the perspective of the market, but also from the perspective of the narrative. What happens here? The protagonist, or what we call hero. So now the principal character in a literary work, leader or champion. Okay. The principal character, the movie is about that person. Okay. And normally most of the films that we watch, they are character centered movies. Okay. That certain character is very important, and everything about the narrative moves around that character. There is another type which is called event-centered narrative or event-centered cinema, where particular event happens and everything is related with this event. Everything is surrounded and this event is in the center. So protagonist is someone who is the center of the narrative. The protagonist or the heroes are virtuous people representing good and morality. Okay. In case of tragedy, they suffer from some fatal flaw. Okay. That is, if it is a tragic film, then the protagonist or the heroes have certain fatal flaw because of which the tragedy occurs. So here I give you some examples of the heroes. We have our own Salman Khan, Mr. Dabang. It is from the Dabang movie. We have Bajirao Singham from Singham movie. We have Veer Pratap Singh from Veer Zara. We have Wat Bakshi is from Holiday. Munna Bhai from Munna Bhai series. And we have Krish, our own superhero. Okay. So what is happening here is something that we should notice as a theorist is all these heroes and majority of the heroes in our films, you can read their names. We have Chulbul Pandey. We have Mulli Prasad Sharma. We have Veer Pratap Singh. We have Virat Bakshi. We have Bajirao Singham. And we have Rohit Mehra or Krish. Okay. So it is something significant, okay, that what names are given to the heroes. Then we have to identify the villains. Okay. Heroes are made. Okay, they are made by the kind of what we call narrative they are part of. Okay. So narrative requirement is the hero. But villains are identified from the society. Okay. So there is this small difference that there is an identified category of the people who can be villain. Okay, and who are villain in fact. Okay. So here a villain is an evil character, whether based on a historical narrative or one of literary fiction. In any case, villain is the an evil character. There are negative aspects related with it, and that's why we call the villain antagonist. Normally, the antagonists are identified group of people. They come from the socially and politically identified categories. Okay. And this is a significant aspect. Their primary role is to make a protagonist the protagonist. That the protagonist becomes the protagonist because there is an antagonist. Otherwise, there will be central character. Okay. So that dichotomy of good versus evil brings is the idea of the protagonist versus the antagonist. So the antagonist is there, then there will be clearly defined protagonist. So the normal villains we have in our films are, there are corrupt politicians like we had in Gangs of Wasseypur, Ramadhir Singh, corrupt businessmen, corrupt officers, underworld dons, dacoits, rebels, foreigners which are terrorists, minorities, and ambitious people. For example, Amjad Khan, Gabbar Singh was a dacoit. We have Dr. Deng, who was an ambitious person who wanted to rule the country by his technology. We have Langra Tyagi from Omkara, who was an ambitious person. Then we have, what was his name? Alauddin Khilji, who was the villain in Padmavat. Then in the movie Rosa, okay, Pankaj Kapoor played the villain who was a terrorist. And in Mr. India, we had Mogembo. Again, he had an ambition that he wanted to rule the country. Okay. So these kind of malicious ambitions, okay, and these kind of negative thoughts are the basic characteristics of the villains. Similarly, we have a very specific role of the heroines in our narratives. Okay. Primarily, they are comforters. Okay. I'll give you some examples. Okay. The positive female characters can be broadly categorized in three categories. Okay. The first one, the one who sacrifices. You have Mother India, you have Sajan Ka Ghar, you have Mohabbatein. Okay. okay, where these important or central characters, female characters, they sacrifice everything for their loved ones. Okay, they sacrificed even their life for their loved ones, for their society. Okay, the second category is the helper, the category of the helper. For example, you have this Miss Hawa Hawaii from Mr. India. You have Madhuri Dixit from Khalnayak. You have Deepika Padukone from Houseful series. Okay. So in all these films and many other such films, what heroine does is she supports the hero, okay, to achieve hero's goal or to save the society from the evildoer. Okay. So basically they are the helper. Okay. Like in Mr. India, Sridevi helps the Mr. India. In Khalnayak, the heroine helps the police officer to capture the villain. In Houseful, heroine helps the protagonist, okay, in playing that game to impress her brother. Similarly, the third category, which is an important category and we need more of those films, the one who revolts. Okay. The women who don't accept and agree with the standard narrative and they revolt against it. Okay. And they, what we call, assert their own identity. Okay. For example, this is the picture from Mirch Masala, where Sonbai fights the entire village to save herself from the Subedar. Or this is the image from No One Killed Jessica, where Rani Mukherjee was a journalist who found out and investigated the case on the Jessica Lal Hatyakand. And similarly, in the movie Kahani, Vidya Bakshi revolts against the stereotypical nature of the society, and she comes forward to investigate and revenge the what we call death of her husband. Similarly, there are negative female characters who are in favor of antagonist. Okay, that there are vamp kind of characters where in olden days we had fixed role, like Helen and Bindu and Aruna Irani, they used to come in that role who will support the villain. Or or they themselves are villain. Okay, like there are some family dramas where the women character who may be a sasuma in the family and who is the villain. Okay. Structurally, even the lead female characters are also and inevitably supported by male characters. Okay. In most of the standard commercial films, okay, there has to be some support of male characters too. The female leads. Okay, like on that day we talked about Pink and Chak De, and you will find many such examples. But fortunately, the narrative is changing, and that is a good news for us. If you check their names, okay, this is Radha, okay, and this is Lakshmi Khanna, this is Megha Shankar. This is Seema Soni. This is Gangotri Devi. And this is Sandhya Rao. This is Sonbai. This is Meera Gaiti. And this is Vidya Bakshi. So again, their names are ideologically significant, socially significant. Okay. Then another important characteristic of Indian cinema is there is a particular love story going on, there is romance, and there is conflict. In the case of romance, that conflict comes in the name of either caste or class or religion. Okay. Like some of the narrative conflicts are generated through the class, caste and religious differences of the lead pair. In case of interfaith love, majority of the times, the protagonist belongs to the dominant groups. Again, this is majority of the time. Okay. So the standard narrative or the powerful narrative is like this. For example, if you see the movie Gadar, okay, Julie, okay, in this movie, the heroine is Christian and the hero is Hindu Brahmin, and they have very specifically emphasized on the caste of the hero in the movie, and this is a standard case of stereotyping. Okay, that how even today Christian characters are portrayed the same way what it was portrayed in the movie Julie. Okay, then in the Bombay film also, the hero and heroine, that is interfaith, the hero is Hindu, heroine is Muslim, Veer Zara, Bajirao Mastani. This is the standard narrative. There will be and there has to be the what we call counter examples, but quantitatively this is the scenario. And there is very interesting argument about the colonization, okay, where they what we call symbolizes colonizers as the males and the colonized as females. Okay, Ashish Nandi most probably talks about it. Even Ganesh Devi in his After Amnesia uses the similar metaphors when he argues about the history of Indian literature. In case of class, protagonists are normally from lower middle class. Okay, when there is the conflict of class, then the protagonist is from lower middle class, or he belongs to the rich family, but he was challenged by the father of the girl that you are nothing yourself, you will have to prove yourself. So, and has to earn his position to upper class to get the heroine. Okay, this is the normal standard narrative going on in our society. Okay, and there are very fixed stereotypes in our films. For example, Parsis are mostly presented as comic characters. The last that I have seen about the Parsi character was this Happy New Year, where Boman Irani played the Parsi character. Okay. Then tribal are stereotype in pre-civilized era, or they are Naxals. Okay. So that is the fixed category of tribals. Lower class people are categorized as antisocial, that if they belong to lower class, then they must be either they are begging, or they are doing something antisocial. Okay. They are selling liquor, or they are the pickpocketers and all those things. Okay. So this is a very fixed belief. Okay. And the stereotype created in our society by the movies. Politicians and police are invariably corrupt, except if they are protagonist. Okay. So if they are protagonist, they are amazingly ethical person. But if they are not a protagonist, then they are corrupt. There is no neutrality. Okay. Then college life is always full of fun, dance and games. Okay. Then, and that is why most of our students, when they enter the college, they'll get a shock. Okay. Which is like they had seen the Karan Johar type of colleges all the time. And when they actually enter into the college, it's completely different, where they have to do assignments all the time. So that stereotype needs to change. Positive Muslim characters are normally the helpers of the protagonist. Okay, like we can see in Doom series, okay, there is a man hero, you know, who is investigating the case, and he's supported by the Muslim character. You can see similar thing in Sarfaroz, you can see similar thing in Dishoom. Okay, even in Patal Lok, same thing was portrayed. And they have used, in Patal Lok, they have used the very word Ansari. Ansari was basically a community who helped Prophet Muhammad in his time. So similarly, Ansaris are taken as a symbol of the helpers. So the same stereotype is used again and again. Okay. Army soldiers are always patriotic and honest. Okay. So these are certain stereotypes that persist in our society for last decades. Okay, it's not just like 5 year, 10 year thing, like when we from And if you think about your villains also, that when we had a bad relationship with China in 1960, when we had the war with the China, so at that time, most of the villains in our action films used to be Chinese people. Then there was Nehruvian socialism came, then there are Jamindars who were the villain. Okay. Or then there was industrialization where the industry people, the owners of the industry were the villain and hero is the worker in the industry and who fights. Okay. The entire angry young man image comes from there. Okay. Then later on, when we have got animosity and powerful animosity with the Pakistan, then you start getting Pakistani villains, and now we have terrorist villains. Okay. So there is a fixed what we call category of villains. In Hollywood also that happens. Okay. That earlier they used to get only Russian villains. Nowadays they have Afghani or Arabic villains. Okay. So the kind of war they are waging, similar villains will come in their movies. Okay. Which is an ideological aspect that as a what we call researcher will have to look at and find out. So we move on to a little theory. It's called cinema spectatorship. Okay. Cinema is all fictional, as they all present something by means of sign. Okay. It's fictional. So that fiction, that imagination is represented with the help of signs. Okay. The signifier in cinema is always imaginary. What we see is signified on screen. Its signifier is imaginary. It should be there in our mind. And that's why we can connect with the characters. That's why we can identify with the characters. So based on this argument, okay, a very important cinema theorist called Christian Metz developed his theory, which is called spectatorship. Christian Metz identified three processes. His implication is that the spectator assumes a masculine subject position. That is, the person who is watching the movie is man. Okay. Earlier, when he started working, Christian Metz's primary concern was the language of the cinema. And in the research on the language of the cinema, he moved on to this perception, the aspect of perception or spectatorship. He's talking about Lacanian psychoanalysis, where there are three categories of imaginary, symbolic, and real. Okay. So what he's saying is that the first important thing that happens in spectatorship is identification. That spectator identifies with represented character. Okay. More importantly, the spectator identifies with the perception itself, what he or she sees. Okay, that is his identification. And what is happening here is this identifying self as a perception, okay, as a perceiver. Okay, so there is a kind of illusion creates in the mind of the spectator that this image is being created by me. Interaction of the picture and my perceptive abilities. So we as a spectator think that we are the producer of this, but basically we are the receivers. Okay. Spectator becomes active producing relationship with the perception, thinking of being a producer. Okay. So this thought of being a producer that creates the illusion that we ourselves are fighting in the film or we ourselves are present in the movies. So that identification becomes very important to enjoy the movie. Then second important part is voyeurism. That looking at something that cannot look back at us. Okay. That we look at the characters on screen. Okay. So when that movie was made, it was when shooting was going on, the characters were present, the spectator was not present. So what character was looking? The character was looking at the camera. but the movie is when it is there in the theater, the character is present, sorry, spectator is present, the character is absent. Okay, so the character is looking at the camera, but it cannot look at the spectator. Okay. So it becomes very ideal situation for the voyeurism. And we are in the theater, it is dark, you cannot see anybody, nobody can see you. So this is the ideal, what we call space for voyeurism. Okay. Because there is no threat that the spectator will be identified. Okay. The spectator does not feel threatened. Here, the spectator is hypothesized as he. Okay, as I mentioned here, that masculine subject position. And third important point that Christian Metz talks about is fetishism, the erotic contemplation of an object or a person. What happens that the object of desire is absent? Okay, the image that you are seeing, okay, of a particular heroine or a particular thing, let's say a car that you like in the movie. Okay. So that object is absent. It is not there. It is just its image. Okay. So the object of desire is absent and the spectator desires the object's image. So spectators are led to believe that what they see is real. Okay. But its signifier does not exist. Its signifier is basically in the mind, it is imaginary. So these three important processes are identified by Christian Metz to understand the cinema narrative, that how cinema interacts with the spectator. But there is this problem that what he is saying, that these are all masculine subject position. That is, the entire narrative of cinema is created for male. Is created for men. So female does not have the spectator space. What will happen? This is one of the most important issues in the history of cinema studies, that what is the position of female in the spectatorship? Okay. Let's move forward with gender spectator. So there is another theorist, Laura Mulvey, presented the idea of gender spectator, okay, where she adds two important concerns of scopophilia. Okay. I'll explain what is scopophilia. The pleasure in looking at an image which is made available to our controlling gaze. Okay. The pleasure is identifying with an image that stands in for us. We identify the image, we take pleasure from it, and the important part is we feel that we are in control of the image. So that idea of control comes with the idea of scopophilia. So what is it? The drive to subject other people to an interested and controlling gaze. Okay. That you look at person and that person is basically your subordinate. So that person cannot go against your will. You are in control. The spectator assumes the role of the observer to a story which is separated from him. He is not directly involved in the story, but he thinks, because he has that power over the narrative, to look at it, because the narrative is going on because of him. Okay. So that particular position is called scopophilia. Here the gaze is masculine, again, taking women as desired objects. Okay, that women is the object, okay, that is desired and subject to scopophilia, that the male spectator wants to control. Setting women up for masculine scopophilic pleasure in looking. Then there is second aspect, identification. Her concept of identification is little different from what Metz was talking about identification. Identification for her is identification of self as the child identifies itself at mirror stage. Mirror stage is an important psychoanalytical concept put forward by Jacques Lacan, where he argues that a child starts developing his or her identity from the day he or she starts looking himself or herself into the mirror. Okay. Because then he is able to see, he or she is able to see the idealized image of the self. Okay. And at the same time, the female gender identifies the role of phallus when they look themselves in the mirror. So this particular argument related with the mirror stage is talked about and adopted by Laura Mulvey when she talks about identification. Okay. So it's not just simply about identifying the character, but it is becoming the idealized image of the self in the form of the character. The other person in image of screen is not the spectator, rather an idealized image. So that idealized image is called the ego ideal by Laura Mulvey in case of film studies, and by Lacan in case of psychoanalysis. So women in this case have to take up the role of narcissistic exhibitionist and become the objects of pleasure for males. Okay. So the role or spectatorial role of the women is being an exhibitionist. Okay. Okay. And this is how the women are normally presented in most of our narratives. Okay. Something that the male likes to watch. Now we will talk about certain signs and codes used in the cinema. So first of them are camera angle and the position of the camera. And with these, I will also talk about little theoretical aspects regarding cinema. So here in cinema, the image will have denotative dimension. That is, you can see the image, so it corresponds to a particular person or a particular object. So that is a denotative dimension. But all images are culturally charged. Okay, that if there is an image of the same example that I used earlier, the chair, it may mean different things in different cultures and different narratives. Okay, and people like Kubrick, Almodovar, Hitchcock, okay, even Bergson, they were very powerful in creating those symbolization, okay, with the help of the images of the objects. Okay. So that identifying the connotation, charged by the connotation procedures, also of the cinema. Okay. So in different languages also they have different codes used as a symbol. Okay. And that we will have to identify from the cultural perspective. When we are say looking at cinema of a particular culture, we will have to identify the codes important in that culture. Okay. Then the important thing here is the position of the camera, since it determines the point of view offered to the spectator, is of immense importance. That where the camera is put and how the image created by the director, okay, is very important, because where you are putting the camera will change the meaning of the image. Okay. So there are different types of shots, angles, for example, crane or overhead shots display the entire landscape. For example, this is called crane or overhead shot. We also call it bird's eye view. That in a single shot, you realize that it is a devastating condition. It shows the result of the war, okay, the kind of havoc it has created in the place. Okay, so with these kind of frames, with this kind of angles, you can observe a large area, and directors normally use to give audience idea, the overall idea of what has already happened here. Then this is zoom in is used to focus on a character or object. Okay, this is from what we call the movie called Kill Bill. Okay, and zoom in here specifically used to show the anger of the character and what she is thinking while fighting. Okay, so zoom in is normally used to show the internal emotion or what is going on in the mind of the character. Then we have high angle shot, which shows the subordination. Okay, that camera is high up and the characters are considered low. Okay, so here what happens, that it is metaphorically shown that the character shown on the screen are inferior characters or subordinated characters from the perspective of the camera. And camera may be point of view shot, like in this case probably they are looking at the villain. Okay, that in front of him they are subordinate, they all had to fight together to tackle one villain. Okay, and that is used in Indian cinema very obviously, especially when they talk about the god and the worshipper, the king and the what we call the other members of the society, or many times villain and what we call heroine ka baap or hero ka baap, who is in a subordinated position. Okay, so that is a what we call ready-made metaphor available to the directors. So the moment they use it, audience will know that yes, they are trying to show that this character is the subordinated character. On contrary to that, there is low angle shot, which shows the superiority. When the camera is down and the characters are up, that shows that the characters are powerful. Okay, so when we looked at that advertisement of Super Housewife and the poster of Singham, so both of them were taken from the lower camera angle, so they become superior. We are looking at it, we are inferior and they are superior. So that is also a ready-made metaphor used by the directors to narrate themselves. Then this is called POV shot, that is point of view shot, and it's not always with the help of telescope. Okay, you will be shown one character, and then you will be shown what that character is looking at. Like this is a scene, the still from the movie The Birds, okay, where the hero is looking at this heroine coming in the boat. Okay, so such shots are called point of view, that the audience is allowed to see from the point of view of the character, that this character is watching this. So this is also point of view shot. There is a character lying on the ground and these two protagonists, they are trying to kill him because the character who is lying on the ground is a fascist character. This is from Inglourious Basterds. Okay, and then there is something called establishing shot. Okay, that you will get a large shot where you see an entire huge area, and this will be used in the beginning of the sequence, implying that the entire sequence is going to happen in this particular place. So it establishes the space. Okay, this is the opening sequence of the movie, James Bond movie Spectre, and this is called long shot. Okay, and normally long shots are used as a conclusion. Okay, when the entire sequence gets over, and then there will be a long shot and you move to the next sequence. Many times the last words, the end of the movie, comes in long shot, implying that everything is solved. So long shots are primarily used for conclusions. Okay. Another type is frames. Okay. That what kind of frames are created by the director? Okay. Because whatever we see on the screen itself is a frame, and we have taken this from a painting, and from painting it came to photography, and now we also use this in cinema. Before that, the meanings of films are generated as much by the connotations constructed by the use of cinematic code as by the cultural meanings of what camera sees. The camera is capturing certain things, and those things are culturally important. So culturally, how cameras picture are interpreted are important. For example, here, centering the subject is one of the important types of frames. That when you put something in the center, okay, it means it is an important thing, or it is the thing that you talk about. Okay. Then there is left to right going away. As I said yesterday, that we have left to right bias. So same thing is happening, that when you go away, okay, when you are, say, when the character is running or walking, okay, if it goes left to right, it means that person was at home and now is going somewhere. Okay. Well, if it is right to left, it means it coming back. The person is coming back. Okay. But many times this kind of codes are broken. For example, here centering the subject, you can see the symmetry. This is the steel from Wes Anderson's Grand Budapest Hotel. And Wes Anderson is famous for his framing. The kind of frames he makes and kind of symmetry he creates in all, okay, he's very, very specific about it. Okay, so any film you see of Wes Anderson, you will find excellent framing. Okay, and you can also see the use of the color that he has made. Okay, that the color of the frock and the railing and the top here. Okay, so everything has the similar color. Okay, so he creates the contrast within the frame. This is left to right going away. This is from the Truman Show. Okay, this is the end sequence of the movie. Jim Carrey, the hero, the Truman, he realizes that he is part of a reality show and he is the hero of that reality show. So then he tries to go into the studio from his home. Okay, and these are the stairs to go there. Okay, so he is captured in the center. And the stair goes up, okay, here, and he's going left to right. Okay, so these kind of sequences, you don't require dialogues. Okay, you don't require language. Just by looking at it, you will understand what the director is trying to say. And different directors create their own signature, their own way, their own technique. For example, as I said, Wes Anderson's technique is his framing. His what we call balance in the frame and balance of the color. Similarly, one more technique, okay, it is called Hitchcock's rule. Okay, the size of the object in the frame should be directly related to its importance in the story at that moment. For example, in this particular sequence, this particular cup was the most important part. Okay. Maybe there is a poison in the cup and it was supposed to be given to the heroine. Okay. And that's why that cup has a very important part in the entire sequence. So Hitchcock puts the cup as a foregrounded object in the frame. Similarly, in his another film called Dial M for Murder, the phone was placed this way, that it was such an important thing. So that importance is given in terms of size, and that happens in day-to-day life also. If you see your institute, Okay, that as a teacher, how much space is given to you? How much space is given to your head? How much space is given to the head of the school or dean of the school? Or how much space is given to the vice chancellor? Okay, so based on their rank, they will be given different size of room. Okay, so that rule is used by Hitchcock in making his movies. Okay, it's called space management. Then this is steal from a South Korean movie by Bong Joon-ho. It's called Thirst. And it is a vampire film. Now, the stereotypical understanding of vampire film is it has to be dark. Okay, and vampires come in the night and they suck blood and they go away. They don't come in light. Okay. Well, this film has a lot of white color, though it was a vampire film. Even you can see here, this was the house of this heroine. And this is the vampire. But the interesting part is this is the kind of counterculture we were talking about, that the vampire is not the villain. The vampire is the hero in the movie. Okay. And that's why there is more whiteness than the darkness. Okay. That whiteness implies the positivity, that vampire was not a bad person. He was the hero. He was not a villain. Okay. So to convey that message of positivity, the director uses the whiteness, fairness in the frames. Then let's move forward. Again, film science and codes, color, lighting and color. How lighting and color is used. For example, you can see this particular frame. Okay, it is from a very good movie, Tumbar. Okay. It was a Hindi film. So what happens here is, any film sequence can be analyzed to discover the relationship between signs in the sequence, that in which sequence the signs are put, and the way that signs from different signifying systems are combined together by means of codes to generate meaning. Okay. So the combination and the selection, these two are important things here. Here, most of the black and white film, like color, is not used in the movie. Okay. Then it will connote the nostalgic recreation. Okay. Or it will create the documentary realism, that whatever is shown in the movie is realistic. It's not a fiction, but it's a kind of documentary. It's a documentation of certain things, like what Steven Spielberg did in the Schindler's List. Okay, this is a steal from that movie. The entire movie was in black and white, except this red jacket of this girl. Okay, so that black and white tone is used, only these two colors are used, because he wanted to create two specific effects, that this is not just a fiction, okay, this is not a fantasy, this is a reality that people have faced, okay, because it was based on true events. And second thing is, he wanted to convey that nostalgia in his narrative, that how people felt at the time and how those who are aware will feel, who are loving, who will feel by looking at the movie. Then strong color can connote surrealism and fairy tale quality. Like when you watch the movies of Wes Anderson, you will never feel that it's a realistic movie. Okay, because he deliberately uses strong colors and he tries to develop a kind of story which is like a fairy tale. Okay. And he always talks about the higher class people, okay, very rich people in his films. Okay. Similarly, this is a poster of the movie Alice in Wonderland by Tim Burton. Tim Burton is also very important from this kind of fairy tale narration. Okay. If you want to understand what does it mean, you should watch his movie called Big Fish. Okay. So here also he has used very, very strong colors to give that impact of fairy tale. And it was actually a fairy tale. The imitation of natural light signifies the realism. Like here, this is natural light. Okay, the light of lantern is there, and that gives the shape to the character. That's all. The other things are not important, not given enough light. Okay, so that also implies the realism. This is also the use of natural light. Okay, but here it shows a kind of what we call a simple life of a person. Okay, then there is something called key light, which illuminates the figures to be shot. That the figures which are to be shown in the movie, okay, or in the sequence, the figures who are supposed to be highlighted, okay, they will be given a key light. So it is the light given from behind. Okay, this is the key light. Okay, there is lighting coming from behind, so the important characters are highlighted. And there is something called field light here. Okay, the field light is used to avoid the shadows. Okay, so there will be lighting from many sides, so you won't see the shadow of the character. Okay, so you realize you feel that it's a natural light. Okay, and very idea of providing natural light means you are seeing the realism, or you are presenting the realism. Then we talk about sound. Before that, cinema uses codes and conventions of representation, which are shared by both filmmakers and audiences. That filmmakers will use only those codes which can be easily identified by the audience, so that the audience actively construct meanings. And this is why you require certain types of stereotyping, okay, because it is easy for the audience to identify. Okay. In terms of sound, we make the difference between two types of sounds. First is diegetic sound, sounds which are on screen, and those sounds are heard by the characters in the cinema. Okay. So whatever is heard by the characters is diegetic sound. For example, dialogue spoken by them, music played on screen. For example, Shah Rukh Khan playing violin, so it is diegetic sound. Or some character plays piano, like in Andhadhun, the hero played piano. So that is diegetic sound. Bomb blast or firing shown on screen, like in movies of our Tiger Shroff, there's a lot of bomb blast and fighting sequences and firing. So whatever voice that we listen as an audience, okay, it is also available for the characters inside. So such sounds are called diegetic sound. Okay. And then there is non-diegetic sound. Sounds which are audible to the audience only. Only we can hear it. It is not audible to the characters on the screen. For example, background music is going on. Okay. Then narrator's voice. Okay, like many films uses the narrative technique. Like in Lagan, there is a commentary of Amitabh Bachchan, okay, in the background. So only audience can hear it. The characters on screen cannot hear it. Okay. Then there are monologue. The one character is thinking, okay, but the other characters cannot know. Now these sound, these kind of things are so well identified by the audience that in cinema they themselves make what we call satire on that. They make fun of it. Like if you have seen this movie Hera Feri, first part, when Babu Bhaiya and Raju asked Sunil Shetty to dial the phone, okay, and in the background Sunil Shetty hears the music, Golmaal Hai Bhai Sab Golmaal Hai, only he hears. it was background music. Okay, and the audience can hear, the other characters cannot hear. So they are basically making comedy out of the standard code of background music, that they are implying to the audience that they are doing, the characters are doing something fishy, and this particular character knows, and that's why he could hear the sound. Now such music connotes the emotional state of the character or some crucial moment in the narration. Okay. Like it is the, what we call, important aspect is the moment's cruciality is increased by use of certain type of music. And some directors are amazing in making use of the music. Hitchcock is one of the best among them, that he creates the entire effect of suspense and thriller with the help of music. If you watch his movies without music, without sound, okay, you may not have that impact that you have when you listen or watch the movie with the background music. At times, such background music is also associated with some characters, like the music is associated with the entry of the character. So with music, you will understand that, oh, this character is coming. Okay, so that is a kind of representational link they create with the help of music. Okay, that audience becomes ready, and audience becomes aware about the characteristics of the character. Okay, that what kind of person he is. Sound is also very important code of engaging the audience. In fact, there is something called suture, that how you attract the audience and what we call maintain his or her attention in the screen. Okay, so one of the most important tool of that suture is your music. Sound also prepares the audience for the upcoming event, and certain type of music is conventionally associated with certain genre or mood. Like there is certain type of music in horror films, okay, or in comedy films, like they use cartoon like music in comedy films, or some mood that if someone is very happy, you will find certain type of music. If someone is very sad, you'll find another type of music. So there is a fixed association. And as an audience, we know that association. We can identify it. All right? So that's all I wanted to say today. For exercise, watch the short film and provide various semiotic signs and codes employed in them. Write about only one movie. Okay. There are two movies, Ahilya and Kriti. I have given a link of both the movies. They are available on YouTube. Both are short films. And this is the link of the form. I'll be sending you the link also.